you. Thank you. I'm Minh. I think I've already had the right introduction. So Mapbox, I work for Mapbox. We make maps, as you might have guessed from the name. So it's a drop-in replacement for frameworks like Google Maps SDK or MapKit. And we have it available for iOS, macOS, Android, web, Unity, React Native, you name it. And in addition to an easy way to drop a world map fully interactive into your application, we also provide simple kits for things like turn-by-turn navigation and working with SceneKit. So there's two things that set us apart from all the other map libraries that there are out there. And the first thing is that this is open source software based largely on open data. And that's important because it lets us make the map utterly customizable. And it allows us to give you full access to the underlying data, something that wouldn't otherwise be possible. We also make it really fun. So this is a free web app called Studio, and it lets you customize every aspect of the map's appearance. That's not just the appearance, but also the content and the structure of the map. I actually liken it to Interface Builder for maps, but without all the auto layout warnings. Now, we don't just make all those options available to you at design time in Studio, but also at runtime, programmatically in Objective-C and Swift. So I won't read this slide out to you, thankfully, but suffice it to say, we offer a lot of options. This is just for lines. So our maps are designed to work at high performance, and you'd imagine a world map that has street level coverage has a lot of data in it. And you also bring a lot of your own data to the app. So to make all that, working with all that data performant, all of our options for customizing the map are declarative. Now, what's that mean? That means instead of looping over all the pieces of data in the map, saying exactly how you want it to look individually, you set up rules and criteria for how broad categories of features behave and look. So I'm going to use the word features a lot. You can think of a feature like an annotation or a marker on a map, except I say the word feature because you can also treat all the information on the base map, like the names of streets and POIs and things like that, also the same way that you would treat an annotation. So here's what I mean by declarative. Say I have data on all the conferences in the world, and for right now, maybe because of a filter, I only want to show just the conferences named option key. I mean AltConf in San Jose. Just these ones right now. So that's the syntax for filtering out the data like that. This is an NSPredicate. That's a built-in Cocoa Foundation class. And I'm checking that name is equal to the option key, and that the year is greater than or equal to 2017. Hi, San Jose. And I had to cast that to a number to be able to make that comparison. So this is the same predicate syntax that you use in core data, and also for filtering arrays in Objective-C. So that should be pretty familiar to a lot of you. Let's say I want to make a label for a feature three times as big when the user taps it to select it. Well, that's pretty simple too. Not using predicate here, I'm using NSExpression, but this is the same idea. So I'm setting the font size of that label to be 16 times either 3 or times 1, depending on whether the feature is selected. Now, for something more advanced, what if, so I've got like all the conferences in the world, but maybe I'm starting out at zoom level 0, so showing the whole world, that's a lot of data, and I don't want to show all the information I have on each conference venue. So I want to progressively show more detail about each feature as I zoom in, as a user zooms in. So this is, that's a little bit more convoluted there. Let me break that down for you. So this is a step function, and basically what's happening here is that I'm starting out at the most broadest view of the world and showing only the country that each conference is in. And then as you zoom in to zoom level 4 to 5 to 11, I progressively show more, like the city, the state, the city. And eventually, I'm showing the city concatenated with the venue name. So in this case, that would be San Jose - Marriott. So this code doesn't work with core data or an SRA. I'm actually pulling some tricks here. And this is a custom syntax. I'll explain in a little bit. That syntax is needed quite a lot when you're working with expressions, because NSExpression has a lot of limitations. So for example, here I've got an average temp attribute on some feature, and it's probably a floating point number, but I wanted to make sure to show it as a readable integer. Unfortunately, there's no round function in NSExpression. So fortunately, there is a way to define custom functions. And David Long wrote an interesting post a few years back on how to do this. But unfortunately, it results in a bit of a convoluted syntax. It's really easy to mistype, not memorable. And in fact, if you mistype it, that's a crash at runtime, not at compile time. We wanted it to look something more like this. More natural, more like the built-in functions in an expression. Turns out we can by extending this class, underscore NSPredicate utilities. And this is the class that implements all those built-in functions. But, uh-oh, that underscore means this is probably looking like an App Store rejection just waiting to happen. So the solution is what we're calling aftermarket functions. It's sort of like the aftermarket car parts that you might have a dealership install or a mechanic install. And the way this works is that we tiptoe around, avoiding naming that class that shall not be named, but we're introspecting it and we're adding methods to it, similar to what a category would be doing at runtime. So we're importing the Objective-C runtime, finding out what class happens to implement the sum function that's built in. That's the NSPredicate utilities class, and we add the method implementations using that runtime. And just for kicks, we defined a C macro to make it super simple. So this is under the hood. You never have to worry about this using the SDK. So why is this a good thing? Well, first of all, if you can categorize something as critical as NS string, legitimately, then why not this class? It ends up looking at using it looks like just like using a built-in function, and it's less prone to typos, so that means less crashes. Just like any time you categorize a class of any sort that's built into the iOS SDK, you want to use a class prefix to avoid nasty surprises when a year from now or 2 years from now, Apple decides to pull fast one on us and rename the class. So there's a lot of these aftermarket functions in the Mapbox Maps SDK. I won't go through them all, but there's a lot of trig operators, the string concatenations, kind of nice. But what can you use these for? Well, what if your data is in one unit, but you want to display it in another unit? So Smoot is a really awesome unit of measurement. It's about the height of a freshman that is used around MIT. And I don't want to just label the map in smoots around MIT. I want to do it for the whole world, including this mountain peak. Here's Denali, and its elevation is displayed in smoots. I did that by converting the elevation M attribute that's in meters to smoots. Then I rounded using that custom aftermarket function, and then concatenate with the word smoots so people don't think I'm talking about meters here. Mapbox maps can also show 3D buildings. But there's a little bit of a problem here. So in a lot of places, a lot of cities, all the buildings are the same height. This is New Orleans. And you can see most of these buildings are roughly the same height there in that street. And as you can see from the screenshot on the top, it looks kind of boring, kind of bland. You can't even tell that there's multiple buildings. But there's a simple solution, which is to dither the heights. This is actually a pretty common technique. You dither the heights, add a little random variation to them. And here we're doing that, well, there's no random function for expressions, unfortunately. So we take the unique IDs of each building and hash them a little bit to make sure that they're just like a smidgen different from each other. So expressions gives you a whole lot more freedom to customize a map. It's really powerful. That's why I named the talk, Freedom of Expressions. And we've only scratched the surface of what's possible. So this was a pretty fast talk. I talk pretty fast, probably. We have full documentation on our website, mapbox.com. You can also reach out to me at 1EC5 on GitHub or Twitter. And if you're curious about the technical underpinnings of this, there's an issue and a pull request in GitHub where we implemented this. And it's open source, so you're free to look at it. It's openly licensed. And I guess that's all I've got. So thank you again for showing up after lunch. Have fun with expressions.
We'd have time for like one or two questions. Anybody got any?
Yes. The expressions themselves or the whole SDK? Yeah, so it can depend. So our SDK adds certainly more than MapKit because it comes with on the device, but a lot less than other frameworks like Google Maps or what have you. So it's actually pretty economical. And we also have other options like static frameworks if you're concerned about size. Yes? So these examples actually, this is actually Swift. It can be used in Objective-C just as well. The format string syntax for expressions and predicates looks identical. Anyone else? Okay, thank you.